Welcome to EPG Patashala. My name is Dugirala Vasanta. I'm on the teaching faculty of the Department of Linguistics at Usmania University. Today's lecture is pertains to course 10, module 26 of Neurolinguistics. It's about methods of lateralization and localization. The main objective of today's lecture is to explain these two concepts, lateralization and localization, and discuss some of the methods which provided basis or supported these ideas of lateralization and localization of brain functions. But the methods I discussed in this lecture belong to the early period of neurolinguistics. They were used prior to 70s, and in recent years they are not being used at all. Okay, let's look at hemispheric lateralization first. What is lateralization? The term lateralization refers to the notion that specific cognitive function is taken over by either the right hemisphere or the left hemisphere. With respect to language, you have learned in the other modules that majority of the language related functions are in right-handed individuals are lateralized to the left hemisphere, because Broca's area, Wernicke's area and all these important language areas are supposedly present only in the left hemisphere. So language functions are lateralized to left hemisphere. This is the main assumption underlying classical model of language brain relationship, which we have discussed in earlier modules. What about localization? So to say that the dominance of the left hemisphere over the right hemisphere has something to do with anatomical asymmetries. As I have just said, that left hemisphere possesses Broca's area in the third frontal convolution and Wernicke's area in the first superior temporal gyrus, and therefore the production is localized to Broca's area, comprehension is localized to Wernicke's area. So this is localization. So, and similarly, I have explained in earlier modules in neurolinguistics that the reading centers are supposedly in the angular gyrus and the supramarginal gyri in the parietal lobe, and of course the visual cortex is in both the hemispheres. So specific functions are localized to specific areas is localization. In this lecture I will be talking about some of the early methods I mentioned. Those methods are ablation experiments on animals, autopsies on brain damaged patients, surgeries on human beings, like taking out a lobe or taking out the entire hemisphere or splitting the two hemispheres, and then electrical stimulation, and finally a behavioral test called dichotic listening. These are the techniques I will be explaining to you in this lecture. The ablation method, the lesion method on animals, is a very old method used in early 19th century. Surgical removal of cerebellum in rabbits, birds and dogs resulted in muscular incoordination and poor balance. So this observation that cerebellum has some role to play in maintaining balance and muscle coordination survived for the next century or so. Now, from animals, they generalized this observation to human beings. And to some extent, it is true. Cerebellum has a role in muscular coordination as well as maintaining balance. And you will learn in other modules that it also has some role to play in controlling prosody and phonological processing and things like that. Then after ablation experiments, they did something called stereotaxic surgery. The term stereotaxic refers to one's ability to manipulate objects in three dimensions, three-dimensional space. So an electrical current is passed through the electrode, which produces heat that destroys a small portion of the brain around the tip of the electrode. After a few days, when the animal recovers from the operation, they see if there are any change. The surgery has resulted in changes in the behavior of the animal. So observing animal's behavior before surgery and after the surgery, they compared it and they tried to say that since they have destroyed a specific area, that area is responsible for this function, which is now gone because that area is taken out. That is called stereotaxic surgery. Then about electrical stimulation, mostly this was done on people who had epilepsy. They did electrical stimulation experiments on these patients, primarily to prevent abnormal electrical activity from spreading from one hemisphere to another hemisphere. So even the split brain surgery was also done for that reason. So Walter Penfield was a very well known neurologist who used these methods on epileptic patients and did what is known as brain mapping. And you have learned in the very first couple of modules in neurolinguistics about brain mapping and Brodmann areas and things like that. So this is called electrical stimulation, and the lobectomy is also. If there is a tumor in one particular lobe or one particular hemisphere, they removed that and they observed changes in the behavior and tried saying that whatever is gone, that particular area of the brain is responsible for that behavior, which is now absent because the area is destroyed. Then there is this test called WADA test of lateralization. Again, these days they are not doing it. It's one of the earlier tests that was used. It was named after a neurologist called June WADA, and it was done in the 60s. And this test is also connected to the notion of handedness, that in any society, majority of the people are right-handed and that their left hemisphere is dominant for language. Okay, and also if suppose there is some problem in the brain and the surgeon wants to know which hemisphere is dominant for speech, so that he will make sure that the surgery will not affect that hemisphere and make the person lose speech after the surgery. So what they did was, this particular WADA test involves injecting a fast acting anesthetic into the carotid arteries, which carry blood from the heart to the brain. And if the left carotid artery, which take the anesthetic, paralyzes the left hemisphere for a few minutes while the patient is asked to speak and the speech is interrupted, they interpreted this to mean that in that particular patient who is right-handed, the left hemisphere is dominant for language. So if you see the next picture, you will see there is an injection, through an injection, sodium emetal is being injected into the left carotid artery, which is going into the left hemisphere. The anesthetic goes into frontal lobe, through the middle cerebral artery. It covers frontal, parietal and temporal areas in the left hemisphere. You know that these areas have the Broca's area and the Wernicke's area and all the language centers. So if this person on whom they are doing the WADA test is right-handed, if you observe the numbers at the bottom of the figure, you see that 96% of the people who are right-handed showed left dominance for language. On the other hand, if if a person is left-handed, only 70% showed left hemispheric dominance. 15% showed bilateral involvement of both the hemispheres, another 15% right hemispheric dominance. So in the left-handers, language dominance is not very clear, but if you are a right-handed, 96% of the time, your left hemisphere manages all your language functions. That's how WADA test talked about language functions being lateralized to the left hemisphere. Now the next method is split brain surgery. In earlier modules, you have learned that corpus callosum is what connects the right and the left hemispheres. Now, Roger Sperry and Michael Gazzaniga are two well-known people who are associated with this surgery. They developed this technique and they again used it with epileptic patients to stop abnormal electrical activity from spreading from one right hemisphere to the other hemisphere. When they split the corpus callosum, the electrical activity cannot spread, but they are able to separate the right and the left, and by administering certain behavioral tests on these patients in a controlled way, meaning that the outside information goes only to the right or only to the left hemisphere, and then they see the response and they correlated what are the functions for which right hemisphere is good and what are the functions that left hemisphere is doing well. So the function of the right and the left hemispheres could be studied separately only on split brain patients. In normal patients, this is not possible because both the hemispheres are connected. There's a lot of communication between the two hemispheres. So to understand what we have learned from split brain patients, you see, when we are looking at objects, visual information from either objects or letters or words coming from the right side falls on the left visual field, and much of it goes to the left hemisphere. Okay, if you study this diagram on the screen, you know the pathways, and the next diagram is much more clearer. Let's look at the next diagram. So in this diagram, you see the green pathway, the pathway marked with green color, is bringing in visual information from the left visual fields of both the eyes, and it is going through optic nerve, optic chiasm, through and it ends up in primary visual cortex. Okay, so the left information falling on the left visual fields, if suppose it's a word, it reaches the left hemisphere. Left hemisphere, you have learned, is dominant for language in majority of the people. So immediately you will name that object without any hesitation. Suppose the information which is falling on the right visual fields, which goes to the right visual fields, which goes to the right hemisphere, you will not be able to name the object immediately. Okay, that is the reasoning in split brain patients. Let me explain a little bit more. So what exactly happens is, when corpus callosum is split, there is no communication between right and left hemispheres. Information reaching the left hemisphere gets interpreted by the patient, who will readily name the object, because left hemisphere is dominant for language. So naming is part of language, task, one of the language tasks. But information that goes to the right hemisphere cannot be, the patient cannot name, because right hemisphere is not dominant for language in majority of the people. Okay. Again, I will show you one more picture to make it a little bit more clearer. Look here, what's happening is the ring, with the information about finger ring, which is on the right side, and it falls on the left visual field of the eye, reaches the left hemisphere. Watch the picture carefully. It is on the left hemisphere. You see the word printed ring, and the patient is saying ring. Because left hemisphere is dominant for language, patient could immediately say, what I see is ring. All right. But if the patient's hand is holding a key. By holding the key, that information falling on the right visual field goes to the right hemisphere, and you know right hemisphere is pretty good at stereognosis, that is ability to know what is in your hand without even looking at it. So the person knows by feeling that it is key, but he cannot name it. If he has seen the word before and if he knows that object is there, he can name it, but not because right hemisphere could interpret that it is key. So I will say one more time. The left side of the brain contains all the important language centers. Therefore, whatever information reaches the left through the left visual field to the left hemisphere, in the picture it is ring, and it is spoken aloud clearly. The right hemisphere is more abstract, and it relates to artistic things, spatial reasoning, stereognosis, and therefore information which reaches the right hemisphere via the right visual field can be drawn or picked out or identified, but not named as well as in the other case that I have just explained. So suppose if the name of the object is projected in such a way only right hemisphere can process it, then the participants might even say, I can't see it, I don't know what, because right hemisphere is not dominant for language, it cannot understand what is there. So if the experimenter asks the participant to feel the object, and that's what you have seen in the picture earlier, and the patient has seen the name earlier before the experiment started with his left hand, He'll feel it with the left hand and identify the object by feeling it. Participant could perform this task without much difficulty because the right hemisphere, having identified the object, can name it. So it is only having identified the object can the person name it, because this information is reaching the right hemisphere, which is not dominant for language. Whatever information reaches the left hemisphere, naming is fast and quick and correct. Okay, so this is how the split brain experiments enabled us to understand that left hemisphere is most of the time processing linguistic information, right hemisphere is good at processing non-linguistic object related information. This will bring me to the behavioral test called dichotic listening test. This test consists of presenting auditory stimuli to both the ears simultaneously. This is to ordinary normal people, adults or children, and the stimuli can be digits or words or syllables, meaningful words or meaningless words or whatever. They reach both the ears simultaneously, and the participant is asked to report what they heard in the named ear, either the left ear ones or the right ear. Okay. The main finding of this particular dichotic listening studies are that participants with left hemisphere lateralization of the stimuli, that is, suppose the words are given to the right ear and they go to the left hemisphere, okay, they name them faster. So even though you are given 25 words here, 25 words here, 20 of the 25 words from the right ear can be reported correctly, less number of words you have given to the left ear can be reported correctly. In other words, dichotic listening tests result in what is known as right ear advantage. That is, most of the words given to the right ear will be reported correctly. See this picture. On the right side, right ear, the word cat is going, into the right ear and reaching the left hemisphere, okay. And therefore, cat will be reported correctly, whichever words are going through the right ear will be reported correctly. On the other hand, dog, the word dog is given to the left ear. Notice word will go first into the right hemisphere and then comes to the left hemisphere through corpus callosum. So the pathway is much longer, alright. So one explanation for dichotic listening is, right, because 80% of the fiber tracks cross over, most of the information which is given to the right ear goes to the left hemisphere, and therefore cat, which is given to the right ear, is reported correctly, whereas left ear words which go to the right hemisphere have to travel much longer before reaching the left hemisphere, and therefore you get right ear advantage. So this method has been modified extensively over the years, I recommend that you look at the e-text for more details about dichotic listening tests and what they're doing and what we can learn from them. In fact, for this whole module, there are several online tests. In fact, there is an online test of dichotic listening which I believe you can play and participate in it. There are also YouTube demonstrations of some of these tests. E-text and additional readings also will give you more information about tests of lateralization and localization. So that brings me to the end of this lecture. Let me just summarize. In this lecture, basically, I have talked about the concepts of lateralization and localization, and I've given you very brief information about some of the experiments they did in the 19th century on animals, ablation and stereotaxic surgery and things like that, and also electrical stimulation on human beings, especially epileptic patients, lobectomies, hemispherectomies, split brain experiments, and then WADA test, and then dichotic listening test. These are the tests I have described briefly in this module. And as I said, you should consult the e-text for more details about what we have learned from all these tests. But basically, what all these tests have supported, offered support to lateralization of cognitive functions, you know, because of the neural connections, the stronger crossover of the neural connections, and also localization. They supported localization concept, saying that certain higher mental functions like language, they are localized in specific areas. There are reading and writing centers in one area, and production center is Broca's area, and comprehension is performed by Wernicke's area. So many of these early tests have endorsed the old idea of localization and lateralization and supported the classical model of brain-language relationships. That's it. Thank you.